got this feeling inside my bones. It goes electric, wavy when I turn it on. Off from my city, off from my home. We're flying up, no ceiling when we in our zone. I got that sunshine in my pocket. Got that good soul in my feet. I feel that hot blood in my body when it drops. Ooh, I can't take my eyes off of it. Moving so phenomenally. You're more like the way we rock it. So don't stop. And under the lights when everything goes nowhere. It's in the air, it's in my blood, it's rushing on. I don't need no reason, don't be control. I fly so high, no ceiling when I'm in my zone. Cause I got that sunshine in my pocket. Got that good soul in my feet. I feel that hot blood in my body when it drops. Ooh, I can't take my eyes off of it. Moving so phenomenally. You're more like the way we rock it. So don't stop that.
Some better sounds no one's ever heard. I wish I had a better voice that sang some better words. I wish I found some chords in an order that is new. I wish I didn't have to rhyme every time I sang. I was told when I get older all my fears would shrink, but now I'm insecure and I care what people think.
My name's Blurry Face and I care what you think. My name's Blurry Face and I care what you think.
Wish we could turn back time to the good old days when the mama sang us to sleep, but now we're stressed out. Wish we could turn back time to the good old days when the mama sang us to sleep. smell will take me back to when I was young. How come I'm never able to identify where it's coming from? I'd make a candle out of it if I ever found it. Try to sell it, never sell out of it. I'd probably only sell one. Maybe to my brother, cause we have the same nose, same clothes, homegrown, a stone's throw from a creek we used to roam. But it would remind us of when nothing really mattered. Out of student loans and treehouse homes, we all would take the ladder.
My name's Blurry Face and I care what you think. My name's Blurry Face and I care what you think.
Wish we could turn back time to the good old days. We would build a rocket ship and then we'd fly it far away. Used to dream of outer space, but now they're laughing at the face, saying, wake up, you need to make money. Yeah. We used to play pretend, give each other different names. We would build a rocket ship and then we'd fly it far away. Used to dream of outer space, but now they're laughing at the face, saying, wake up, you need to make money. Yeah. Wish we could turn back time to the good old days when the mama sang us to sleep.
Used to play pretend, bunny. We used to play pretend, wake up, you need the money. Used to play pretend, used to play pretend, bunny. We used to play pretend, wake up, you need the money. Used to play pretend, give each other different names. We would build a rocket ship and then we'd fly far away. Used to dream of outer space, but now they're laughing at the face, saying, wake up, you need to make money. Yeah.
Close your eyes. Does it almost feel like nothing changed at all? down to get down tonight. Cause it's always a good time. Slept in all my clothes like I didn't care. Hopped into a cab, take me anywhere. I'm in if you're down to get down tonight. Cause it's always a good time.
Good morning and good.
So great to be with you and excited for today. We've got Ken Bell, who is frankly an icon in this industry. And if you don't know him, he has sold some of the largest pieces of property on the Utah market and the luxury home market. And so we're so excited to have him be part of our conversation today. And of course, you know, before we start, we're going to start with our affirmations, our power statements, and incantations. So let's rock and roll here with our self-confidence formula with Napoleon Hill, and here we go. First, I know I have the ability to achieve the object, my definite purpose in life. Therefore, I demand of myself persistent, continuous action toward its attainment, and I here now promise to render such action. Second, I realize that the dominating thoughts of my mind will eventually produce themselves in outward physical action and gradually transform themselves into physical reality. Therefore, I will concentrate my thoughts for 30 minutes daily upon the task of thinking the person I intend to become, thereby creating in my mind a clear mental picture of that person. Third, I know through the principle of auto-suggestion, any desire that I persistently hold in my mind will eventually seek expression through some practical means to tame the object back of it. Therefore, I will devote 10 minutes daily to demanding of myself the development of self-confidence. Fourth, I have clearly written down a description of my definite chief aim in life, and I will never stop trying until I shall develop sufficient self-confidence for its attainment. Fifth, I fully realize that no wealth position can long endure unless built upon truth and justice. Therefore, I will engage in no transaction which does not benefit all it affects. I will succeed by attracting to myself the force I wish to use and the cooperation of other people. I will induce others to serve me because I have my willingness to serve others. I will eliminate hatred, envy, jealousy, selfishness, and cynicism by developing love for all humanity because I know the negative attitude towards others can never bring me success. I will cause those to believe in me because I believe in them and in myself. I will sign my name this formula, commit it to memory, and repeat it aloud once a day with full faith for the gradual influence of my thoughts and actions, so I will become a self-reliant and successful person. Hoorah! All right, here we go. 12 steps to the summit of success. This is a 12-step formula with minimum standards, which, when followed with exactness in a positive environment, ensures 24-plus transactions annually and unprecedented personal growth and achievement. One, I dedicate 1 hour daily towards building and protecting my self-confidence. Two, I practice and internalize my sales skills for a minimum of 1 hour each day. Three, I contact my sphere of influence by mail, by phone, and or in person, and by email quarterly. Four, I make 150-plus contacts per week, 30-plus per day, by phone or in person. Five, I follow up on my qualified leads daily. Six, I set 5-plus appointments per week with buyers or sellers. Seven, I can frequently qualify 100% of my appointments. Eight, I have an appointments attended listing taken ratio of at least 50% or greater. Nine, I call my sellers weekly and reduce all listings every 3 weeks a minimum of 5%. 10, I sell 75% or more of my listing inventory. 11, I'll return every signed call and contact every buyer lead within 2 hours of inquiry. 12, I only work with high qualified buyers who've been pre-qualified by a mortgage lender and have signed a buyer broker agreement. Earn more commissions and less time with less energy spent. I recognize success comes from consistent action resulting in predictable outcomes. Therefore, I commit to following every step of the 12 steps to the summit of success. All right, gang, keep it rocking. Here we go. If you're not standing, stand up. Get engaged. Give yourself 100% effort. All right, I'm a professional salesperson who gets home sold. I use information my clients achieve their goals. I price my listings right. I focus on small wins every day. Real estate transactions are abundant in any market. My abilities make me succeed. I get stronger with every thought. I take extra care of my body. I start each day with an abundance of energy. I am task-oriented. I set clear praise daily. I know what I want and I get it. I attract and enjoy greater financial abundance each day. My gratitude gives me unlimited financial success. I think prosperous thoughts. I am prosperous. I handle my money wisely and I profit every day. Taking action is easy for me. I am eager to start each day. I enjoy being debt-free. I exercise daily. I enjoy helping my clients succeed. I eat healthy foods. I'm a real estate expert. My SOX makes me be their real estate expert. I'm a professional. I'm financially independent. I earn commission with ease, helping others. I have solutions. Prospect is good for my business. I call expireds and for sale by owners. Prospect is easy for me. I enjoy falling at my SOI. People are attracted to my enthusiasm. I use technology to succeed. I get mentally strong with every call I make. I'm an outstanding salesperson. I'm a powerful agent. I know how to succeed. I keep positive, exciting, fun, productive thoughts of mind all the time. Yes. All right, here we go. So we're going to take exactly 5 minutes, and we are going to spend some time, as you know, we're going to write down those things that we're grateful for. All that gratitude, feel it, write it, experience it, emotionalize it, and make sure that you are going from a place of gratitude. Remember, the antidote to all fear is gratitude. And then, of course, move into your intentions and write down 10 things that you intend to have happen, whether it's short-term goals, long-term goals, just what you want to have happen even just today. Make it happen, gang. Look, take the time, the energy. This is about developing a strategy for your future. It's about living every day in beautiful space through gratitude, love, light, brightness, and making sure that you set the intentions of your heart, your actions, and your desires to move forward every single day. All right? So here we go. 5 minutes. We're going to do that. Take out a piece of paper. Take out your journal. And let's roll. We'll be right back.
All right, let's get rolling here. Hey, so one, thankful for everyone being here. We've got a great group on the line here, but most importantly, I'm grateful that Ken Bell is with us. And I have to apologize. I know he's been in the business, I think, 3 decades, if not more. And so Ken has a long, long history of extraordinary service in the real estate industry, but has also sold some of the most prestigious and amazing homes across the Wasatch Front in Salt Lake City, Utah. And his name is really an icon to luxury real estate and luxury homes, which is fun to see. So Ken Bell, welcome. We're grateful that you're with us. Thanks for being here.
Oh, thanks, George. I appreciate being with you. This is an honor, unexpected actually, to be able to do this.
But I'm grateful. We have to wrestle a few people to get involved on this. But man, we're so excited that you're here. And I know it's a little nerve wracking, but at the same time, it's such a great contribution to people who want to become more and who are trying to achieve more. So thank you for being with us.
Well, I appreciate being here, and I appreciate everybody who's trying to make a living. It's not an easy business.
No, it is not. It is not. Well, instead of me giving, in fact, now I have your mind, instead of me giving some of the answers to your life and how, tell us just a little bit about yourself. Tell us a little bit who Ken Bell is and how he started in real estate. And I'm going to guess that you didn't come from deep rooted wealth, but and tons of money in your past. But I presume that you've created those opportunities and created that within your life with your own hard work and your disciplines. And we're excited to hear more about that. So tell us just a little bit about your career. How long have you been in the business? How did you get your start? And then I'll ask, I'm sure, another other questions in the midst of that.
Sounds great. Well, thank you. Your guess at 3 decades was a decade short. I actually started in December of 1976. Terracor. You probably remember Ellis Ivory.
I do.
As it started Terracor long ago. I had just graduated from the University of Utah. Didn't have a job. Thought I would be doing something else. I really had planned to go get a further education in Chicago, in Northwestern, in Illinois, and that was working out a year after I wanted it to. And we just had Sam. Whom everybody knows, I think. He was a new
addition. I don't know if everybody knows. So Sam Bell, right? So that's Sam Bell. You're his father.
Yes, and I needed to provide for he and his mother, and I didn't have a job. And so Terracor offered me an opportunity to start selling real estate for them, living in Salt Lake City, but selling real estate in St. George area, which is 300 miles away. But they wanted me to stay in Salt Lake City and sell product in St. George, which was kind of interesting.
Yeah, that is interesting. Was that Bloomington?
That was Bloomington. Yeah, there were.
Yeah. Okay.
Now it looks like an old developed community. Then it was, I think, 4 townhomes on a golf course and about 6 spec homes and 500 lots. So,
wow, there
much there. But they, and you know, I've got to say that it's been a pleasure being with Century 21. For those of you who don't take advantage of the training and the things that George is trying to do in helping you understand. I love the affirmations that you just went over this morning, George. I think for all of you who are starting in the business, if you'll do what those affirmations ask you to do and what you're sort of affirming to yourself you're going to do, things will work out. It may not happen. Real estate for me was not a quick success. It took years to build the clientele, but if you just keep doing the things that you're saying on that,
well, thank you.
Things work out. So take advantage of the training. That's where I wanted to go with that. When I started in real estate, I had a wonderful office. It's right on South Temple in Salt Lake, the corner of about 550 East. It's a great stone mansion, and they gave me an office upstairs. And my training was a telephone on a desk, the phone book, we don't have phone books really anymore, and a list of about 10 clients that the previous person had tried to work with and didn't do much with. And they said, there you go.
That was it.
Go sell something. You know? And the product was 300 miles away. So for the opportunity.
I did not know this part of the story. That's crazy. I did not know that. I didn't know that you worked with Ellis either. That's interesting.
Well, he had actually gone about a year before I got there, but he was one of the founders of the business. And, So it was just kind of you're all on your own start, you know. Here's a phone book.
Right.
To have the training that's available now and to be able to maybe have mentors in the business and coaching and all of that, you know, there's just really all the opportunity in the world for all of you who are starting out or even have been in the business a long time to take advantage of that. Keep on top of the technology. I think that's one of the things over the years. I started with a phone book and a telephone, and that was the technology. We didn't have fax.
And of course you had the book of real properties. There was no technology, essentially.
There was no technology. Yeah, there was no internet. So they had just gone from every brokerage kind of being itself. There was the multiple listing was a new arrangement. So each office was competing against each other. There wasn't really a cooperative agreement between offices. So you may see someone's listing and say, gee, I could sell that to somebody, but they may not let you show it. So that wasn't good for their client. It wasn't really good for them, but that was a long time ago, but quite
interesting. Yeah. So talk about just that transition. So you started there at TerraCore and you moved from that. And then how did you move forward? I mean, how did you move to where you're selling multi-million dollar properties? I mean, obviously that's not how you started. How did you move through that process of elevating your sales prices, getting the confidence? Like, how did you move through that? And maybe a little bit more of a gap. Obviously, we're talking nearly 40 years of time. How did you move from that? And then you opened your own brokerage and you had it to where it was really just, you know, Ken Bell and Associates. I mean, it was, you know, you really put a name out there for yourself as you move through this.
Well, and I appreciate that. And frankly, that did happen. But it took, you know, really a decade to get to a point where I was on a foundation that I could start selling those higher priced homes and building a sort of a reputation, branding yourself. I guess that would really be a better way of putting that. Brand yourself, build a niche, you know, in the market where you understand who you are and what it takes. But
really your biggest branding efforts were the fact that you put signs out in the marketplace, right? Yeah. I mean, I know that you put ads out and you had different, you know, back in the day, I still remember where you'd have your name in the local magazines and the Homes Illustrated, right? Exactly. But really the biggest branding, like people always want to talk about branding, but I think the biggest thing that I've seen is that if I drive down still today, you know, Holiday Boulevard, or I drive down some of these luxury home streets, is I see your sign. So yeah. Sometimes I think we get so consumed with thinking that we need to brand ourselves in different ways. But my observation is how I know you before I knew you and how I came to know your name was the fact that you had signs up. So
yes.
The biggest thing that I've seen you do is that you not only listed homes, but of course you sold them.
Yes.
And that combination was the best branding that I've seen. And I always knew who you were and I'd never met you.
Yeah, no, and you're absolutely right. I remember George in 1981, I just started to, I'd moved from TerraCore to a little company, Realty World Concord, owned by a friend of mine that had bought it from a fellow that wasn't, as honest as he should have been as a broker, but he was my broker. He actually took advantage of me and it took, he almost put me in bankruptcy with some things he'd done. I bought a property from him and he didn't make the payments. I bought it on a contract. And so I he didn't make payments. So I had to go make all of the payments over again and kind of put me in a very difficult situation. But I have to credit him for telling me something that probably made my real estate career one of the foundation points, and that is just exactly what you're saying. He took me to lunch one day. He'd already taken advantage of me. I was trying to decide whether to sue him or not, but he sat down with me and he said, he gave me five words. He said, Ken, if you list, you last. That was it. And I thought, you know, he's right. You got to have signs. And so the very next weekend, there was a for sale by owner around the corner from the duplex we were living in and owned. I knocked on the door, met with the owner, was able to convince him to let me list it. I listed it and sold it, and I let all the neighbors know, and they happened to be neighbors of mine too. And then I listed something else in the neighborhood. This was in Midvale, and it just started to grow from there. But I think one of the foundation pieces for me is just exactly what you're saying, George. If you list, you last. Go list a property in the neighborhood you want to farm, where you want, or in the price range that you want to be in. Work at it.
How did you move into the luxury space? I mean, I know that look, one of the transactions over the years that we did was a small little condo, and I know that you kind of had an array of different sales prices, but I mean, you really have done an exceptional job in the luxury side of the market. What happened for you to transition into that? How did you mentally get into that space? Because sometimes it's, I mean, I presume, did you grow up with tons of money?
No.
You didn't grow up in one of the mansions that you sold?
No. In fact, okay. When I was young, we lived in a mobile home in Wyoming. And so that's where we started. My dad was a great guy, provided for us. Yeah. We had something to eat, but we lived in a mobile
home. How did you transition to the luxury side of the business? How did you transition mentally, and then of course even the physical side of it, but how did you do that?
Well, you know, we actually decided to move to Holiday in 1984. That was, of course, a long time ago now.
Sure.
We bought the worst home in the neighborhood and fixed it up. But we began to you know, that some of the homes in Holiday are more expensive homes. And that move allowed me to begin to know the people there. And I began to just let them know I was in the real estate market. You have to be willing to go out to the people that you want to work with and market yourself. And that can be intimidating, especially when they may have a ton more money and they may be, have a reputation in the world and community that you don't have. How do you approach them? Well, you know, you may not know that, but for me, we moved into the neighborhood. I just started approaching them, and it was also a matter of I had confidence. One of your affirmation points, in that I knew more about real estate than they did. I really tried to keep myself on top of the market. I tried to be. I figured if I wasn't going to get a PhD like I thought I was going to do, that I would learn enough about real estate that I gave myself a PhD in what does it take to understand the real estate market. I knew that I knew more about what they needed with their real estate needs than they did, and that I could help them. And so I had that confidence about my understanding, and then I began to approach them. I also began to farm with that area. With that group of people. So I would send newsletters out. You know, this is before there was social media and all of that stuff. So the mail was something to do. And I decided to invest in newsletters. So, you know, I was sending out hundreds and hundreds of newsletters at the end of my career. Well, it was over 1,000 every month went out to a sphere of influence that I developed over all of those years. But I was in contact with that group of people. Every other month, they heard from me. And then if I got assigned in their neighborhood, if I listed a home in the neighborhood, they got I just listed a home in your neighborhood card for me. And pretty soon, meaning within a couple of years or so, people begin to say, well, you know, Ken really knows this part of the market. Ken really knows the neighborhood. I see his sign. I get these things in the mail. And all of a sudden, I started getting, you know, phone calls on a rather consistent basis from these folks that I'd been farming. And every time I got a listing, they'd see it. I'd tell them about it with my mailers or even call the neighborhood and say, hey, we've got a new listing around the corner. And if you have a friend or somebody, just let me know. I'd be happy to tell them about it. Or you can bring them over and show them or have them bring their realtor with them and come. But they knew that I knew their market as well or better than anybody. In fact, I was selling more homes in that area, Holiday, than than any agent for a number of years, you know.
Right.
So Connie Smith.
Well, I mean, just some of the gold nuggets. I hope people are hearing this. I mean, for me, what it is, one is, you know, the PhD of, you know, basically mastering your craft, you know, mastering exactly what it is you're doing. And I think sometimes we tiptoe around this industry as more of a, hey, well, can I make a little bit of money? And I don't really have to know much about it. But my observation of what you've done is that not only did you know your neighborhood, did you know the market, did you know the people, did you know more about the industry, did you know more about those contracts, did you really took the effort. And then I love the fact is you reshaped your story, which was the intimidation factor of someone who is worth a lot, has a huge property, makes a lot of money. And you reshaped and realized that if I told myself a different story, which was, look, I know more about real estate than they do. I mean, that's a simple statement, and meaning that so that you could step forward with confidence, you could step forward with that belief within yourself. I mean, that's powerful. I remember years ago, Earl Nightingale, if you remember his name, Ken, do you remember Earl Nightingale?
Sure do.
Earl Nightingale had this statement that he would make, and he would always say this. He would say three things. He would say, always live in the most expensive area. And I think it's interesting is that I moved out of a Holiday a long time ago and quickly moved back. And one of the things I realized in that short period of time was the importance of surrounding myself with people who want to also be wealthy. And I think there's a statement in regards to you moved to Holiday, and I lived in the most smallest of homes.
Yeah.
And although those homes now today are selling for $550,000-$600,000, but I lived in one of the smallest homes. I remember when it was a family home. My mother bought it for $65,000 on Southmore Drive.
Yeah.
You know where that is, of course. Yeah. And those homes now are selling for $550,000, which is crazy to think of. But back in that day, I remember early on when I heard Earl Nightingale say that, and it made me kind of wake up to the idea that if I want to change the way I think, so much of it has to do with who I spend my time with.
Yeah.
And if I wanted to increase my ability to think in terms of wealth, well, why don't I get around the people who are wealthy? So the people I started spending time with, of course, were Ellis Ivory, you know, the owner or the former owner, although he sold to Warren Buffett, you know, Bill Child, you know, all these different people became really, really close friends, from the Reynolds to Brad Reynolds, all these guys that you know, but my association with them changed the way I think, because of the things that they had accomplished. And I was just a young man when I started to associate with these people, and it made a huge impact. So I think the thing that I'm taking away from that, I hope everyone's hearing that, is you made a real conscious effort to spend time with the right people so that you could elevate economically around them, because we become who we spend our time with. And I think that we sometimes forget that. So if we're not spending time with the right people, you've got to make a proactive effort. Like, take time and energy to get with the right people. I don't know what your thoughts are to that.
No, that's absolutely right. In fact, it was clearly that for me to try to get into a position where I could be with people who could afford to buy real estate. You know, when I first started, all my friends were my age. I was 23 years old. I couldn't afford to buy a house, and neither could any of my friends. And so how do you find people that can afford to
When I started, I was living in a basement apartment of Jennifer's grandfather. I mean, that's where I was. That's where I started.
You got to start associated. One of the reasons I moved to the area we moved to too was not only for me, it was for Sam and for my family. I wanted my children to grow up thinking I can do anything. If I want to be the best river guide in the world, I can do that. If I want to be president of a company, I can do that. If I want to be whatever it is, there's no limit in my head as to what I can do. And I wanted them to grow up with people who thought that way. And that's one of the reasons we moved there. And I wanted to think that way. It's exactly what you're saying, that I could do whatever I chose to do. If I chose to be successful, I could be successful. And so that was part of making that move there. It was
great
for my family as well as for me. And I think all of my kids have grown up and been successful. And some of that had to do with the fact that you know, we were a family, but some of it had to do with the environment that they grew up in. I remember in Sam's, I think it was Sam's fourth grade, Cottonwood Elementary, fourth grade school, Johnny Miller's daughter, Johnny Miller lived in the neighborhood for a while, the golfer.
Right.
He came to their elementary class and signed golf balls for everybody. How many people have the guy who won the Masters golf tournament come to your kid's class just because his kid's in the class? Well, you grow up thinking, I got a ball from Johnny Miller. And you think, well, that's cool. Well, and you see him on TV and you think, yeah, I can do that. That my neighbors do that. As a kid, you don't think that. Do you understand what this does to your mind? This
exposure.
You think you can do anything and it's exposure. And then Johnny Miller called me a few years later and said, hey, Ken, I'm moving. I got to, I'm buying this place in Park City. And what about my house? And, why did that happen? It's because, we had moved to that neighborhood. I decided to try to work that market. And, you begin to get calls like that from people who know you're there and they think you can do it. You know you can do it as far as helping them. So you're
great,
absolutely
Ken.
Right.
Well, and to your point, now, and I both know this, there's multiple luxury markets across the state of Utah and, of course, in California, which a lot of our agents are. But back in the day, obviously, you went to an area where really that was the majority of where luxury homes were and the avenues and such.
Yeah.
So let me ask you this. So for an agent who is struggling, for an agent who, right now the market, as we all know, whether it be Utah or California, is white hot. Is there some differences in different price ranges? Yes, but I'm not necessarily want to get into that. But what I want to get into is that if you have an agent who you knew was really having a struggle and was really, just feeling the anxiety of the market, what's going on, a lot of fear around, obviously there's the political environment, there's the civil environment, there's the health environment, there's the economic environment. For you, what counsel would you give to an agent today in today's market from what you can see?
Well, and that's a really good question. I was actually contemplating that a little bit yesterday as I was thinking about what we're going to talk about today. There whether it's a good time in the market or not, if it's a challenging time, I think the thing that we as agents need to do is understand that there are principles. There are true principles of business and of conduct, personal discipline. That if you keep doing them, regardless of what the market is, you will have success. Whether it's good or bad or ugly, if you go out and you do something good today, if you go out and help somebody today, that will turn back into something good for you. And so you have to believe that if you have to learn what those principles are, and I think your affirmations give you a number of those that you should be doing. For me, for instance, and I've done that. You could ask Sam about this if you want, but I'm kind of fanatic when it comes to a routine. So and it started in high school with a wrestling coach who said, if you do push-ups and stuff every morning, you're going to be successful. Well, for 50 years, every morning I do, I have a little over half an hour of a workout. I do it at home because it takes less time and I don't feel like I have a lot of time to run to the gym. I know a lot of people go to the gym and that's great too, but just get a routine. I conquer myself every morning. Physically, I get up and meditate. I read scriptures, frankly, and get that in place. And then I do my half an hour of a number of push-ups and other things that I do.
Sure.
And then I get started on the day. But by 8 o'clock in the morning, I will have sort of conquered there are days you get up and say, I don't want to exercise. It doesn't matter. I get up and exercise anyway. I get out of bed and say, I don't want to exercise. I exercise anyway. It's kind of, you get up and say, I don't want to call for sale by owners. You get up and call for sale by owners anyway. The market's good. I don't need to call for sale by owners. Get up and call for sale by owners anyway. It's just that kind of a mindset that I think if you know there are principles like farming a neighborhood, farming a price range, whatever it is that you do in business, improving your skills, your knowledge and so forth. you should be doing that every day, come rain or shine. You'll know, I'll give you a little secret. This comes from Mike Lindsey. You know who Mike is.
Sure, of course.
He's a very successful agent here in Salt Lake City, not with with Everest, but he and I have kind of competed all of the time over the last 30 years. But I can tell you that when Mike started out, he started out kind of the same way I did. Every day, I think he cold called for 4 hours a day. Todd Eager was his broker, and I knew Todd. And Todd and Mike, I don't know that he still does that, but you know, Mike does a lot of high-end things in our market as well.
Well, I remember talking to him. He said he just opened up the phone book.
He would just
call any number at that time in life, right? Because it's different today. Because there's luxury markets everywhere in Utah today. But
sure.
He would just only call phone numbers that were in the luxury areas. And he just made it at 18 years old. Man, he decided he was going to be a luxury agent.
Yep, and that's what he did. He just started calling. He had called builders. He called, but 4 hours a day, every day. I don't know if he did it over the weekends, but I know he did it every single day of the week. I knew it was crazy.
Well, you,
that kind of discipline.
So Ken, you said, okay, so you've used some really, work. I would say a poor result always comes from a poor structure. So part of what you've expressed here is, and you and I have never really sat down and had deep conversations about this, but what I think to your point you said earlier, and that is that truth, in so many words, is truth.
Right.
Right. True principles. Right. So you're talking about conquering your morning, and if you can conquer your morning, I've always said that if you can master from the moment that you wake up to about 12 noon, you will make a fortune in this business.
Yep.
And I've had an affirmation that I've said to myself for years, which is, it doesn't matter how I feel, I do my job anyway. And you said, look, it doesn't matter if you don't feel like calling for subliners, call them. It doesn't matter whether you feel like prospecting. It doesn't matter whether you say to yourself, I don't really feel like exercising today. You exercise today. And right. I find that fascinating. That seems like I hope that people, it seems like such a simple concept that you've given. But the fact of the matter is it is mind-blowingly important into how you shape your life and you shape your business. So I'm hearing, like, what are the particular structures that one should have? Or, exercise, practicing, role-playing, prospecting, and doing key things. And I've always said these three things too: prospect, exercise, and practice.
Yeah.
If you do those three things and don't waver from them in this business, you will make a fortune in this industry.
I absolutely agree. I just think it really is that simple. It doesn't mean immediate success. But I think if you do that consistently, like you're saying, George, it works. How can it not work?
How do you overcome the fear, the anxiety of picking up the phone or knocking the doors? We're not seeing as much door knocking, of course, but let's just say, but there's no reason that would be, how are people supposed to overcome the fear, the rejection, I just don't feel like prospecting, picking up the phone. How do you break through that? What counsel would you get? What do you do and what have you done from a mental side to overcome those things too?
Well, first of all, I think you have to acknowledge that it's going to be there, and that you have to decide, regardless of whether or not I fear doing this, I really want to succeed more than this fear. So my desire to succeed is greater than the fear that I feel. And if you can get that in your mind, and that's kind of what I think exercise in the morning does, and these affirmations, it gives you the strength to say, I will not give up. You know, I can win. I do this myself, and my desire to succeed is that strong. So
you're saying, make sure I'm clear. I just want to make sure you're acknowledging, in fact, Chad Wagstaff, one of your dear friends and agents that worked in the business with you, he just loves you.
He's awesome.
Yeah, he is.
And I knew he was going to be a big winner in this game. He's still got a lot to go, and I mean, he'll do a lot more than he's already done, and he's already well on the way.
Yeah,
so.
He's doing great stuff. But I'm hearing something really profound here, which is that when you think about what it is that you're supposed to be doing, is really acknowledging the emotion that's coming there. I mean, Ken, you're saying something so critical. Sometimes we want to act like we're not scared when we're scared. Sometimes we want to say we're not sad when we're sad.
Yeah.
And the thing I've realized over my lifetime, and you've said something so profound, which is acknowledge the emotion for a moment. What I'm hearing is, hey, it's okay to say you're scared to call or pick up a phone. Okay, I'm scared. Okay. But then my desire to win, my desire to conquer, my desire to have more is stronger than my desire to stay in the fear.
Yes.
And so you conquer it. But I think there's something really important about acknowledging that we're fearful, acknowledging that we're feeling the fear of rejection or the anxiety. Okay, I'm anxious. Okay, acknowledge it. But now still go do your job.
Yeah.
Really, I think sometimes we try to hide that our feelings don't exist, but they do exist. But it doesn't mean you can't overcome them. But acknowledging them, as you said, is a really important principle.
Yeah, it really is. I think that they're going right along with that, and you've already brought this up, is the fact that you need to decide that you want to succeed and that you want that more than anything, more than fear. You're willing to go through that more than lack of success just because you didn't make it today. Because I got to tell you, whether the market's good or bad, there are going to be days that you won't succeed. There are more doors shut in your face than open to you. Always, even when you've been successful, even if you're the salesperson of the year, that year you still had more doors shut in your face than open for you.
Yeah, you did, right? Because you were the salesperson, the realtor of the year for the state, yeah. For the Salt Lake Board, right? Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. So you have to kind of do what you're talking about. Step aside and say, look, there's always going to be fear. You know, I was a little nervous this morning thinking, what's George going to ask me? What should I say? You know. But
sure,
you know,
sure.
I'm grateful to be able to share, and you know, we all learn together. But I think you're absolutely right. You need to understand that you're going to face fear. You're going to face failure. You're going to face success. Success can be a problem. If you really think you're that cool sometimes, you're really probably not. Because the next guy you meet, I got to tell you, every client you meet really doesn't care if you've been salesperson of the year or if you've not been salesperson of the year. They care that they think you can get the job done for them and that they can trust you. Trust is what this whole business is built. Success in real estate, I think, is built on trust. And trust comes from believing that that person will care for you, that they're competent enough to make it happen, and that they're loyal to you, you know, those kinds of things. So, you know.
Powerful. That's powerful. I hope everyone's hearing that.
Yeah.
That is so powerful, Ken.
So anyway, I think you do, like you say, you have to acknowledge the fact that you're going to have fear, you're going to have failure, you're going to do all those things. And you know what? Doesn't matter. I'm going to keep rolling on. If I have fear today, I keep moving. If I fail today, I keep moving. If all heck breaks loose, I keep moving. And at the end of that, you have victory. You'll have some scars. But
yeah, or like Napoleon Hill talks about, right? Temporary, there's always going to be temporary setbacks.
Right.
In his book, Think and Grow Rich. So temporary setbacks, keep going forward. And mm-hmm. I love the statement that Tony Robbins always says. He says, when you don't know what direction to go, keep going forward.
Exactly.
Right? Keep going forward when you don't know what direction. So sometimes people take left turns, right turns, U-turns, you know, paralyzed. And the point is, keep going forward.
You know, and I think that's absolutely right. And sometimes you may even say to yourself, what is forward? Where is forward? Well, forward is the true principles you already know about. Call for sale by owners, get out of bed, talk to somebody, say, I can help you with your real estate needs. You do that, somebody's going to say yes. It may take you 10 tries, may take 100 tries, you're going to get somebody.
And it doesn't matter. And sometimes our gaps are this wide to succeed. Sometimes they're this wide, or maybe they're as wide as the Grand Canyon. Yeah. But no matter what, if you will persevere and persist, as to your point, that's why I've always said this business, there's nothing you can't learn. There's nothing you cannot do. So what I'm hearing from you is, look, it doesn't matter how big the gap is to your success, to where you are, to where you want to be. You can get there. It's just the question is, are you going to do all the left turns, U-turns, paralyzation, off days, don't prospect, don't call for sell banner, don't knock on a door, don't call your just listed, just solds, don't speak to your sphere, because every day that we do that is one day back that we hold ourselves back from the things we really want out of this business.
Yeah, I think it's absolutely right. And there are times you need to say to yourself, too, just, I need a break so I can breathe and look in the mirror and say, oh, yeah, my name's Ken. I remember that, you know, whatever it is. And I think if you make a conscious decision that day I'm doing this, because that is one of the keys to success, is taking some time to sharpen the saws, as Steve or whoever, that's okay. But if you're
doing it, is okay, as long as it's part of the, right? It's part of, to your point, part of your structure, part of the plan.
Right, exactly. So
that's great. I mean, in fact, the tragedy is you see these people, they'll go on a vacation and they're working when they're on the vacation. I'm not talking about return if you mean versus taking the vacation because they're supposed to be on vacation and working when they're supposed to be working. The problem is they're not working when they're supposed to be working. So then they go on the vacation, they start working when they're on vacation.
Yeah.
That's one of the great tragedies to any family has to deal with that. I'm not saying there isn't work that might have to be done for a little bit that gives the, you know, I'm talking about that, like people are in panic work on a vacation because it didn't work when they were supposed to be working. And that's the great tragedy. Yeah. So Ken, this is crazy. Time goes so fast on these, and I'm so grateful for your time and so grateful that you would spend some time just teaching us and sharing your wisdom with us. For just a thought or two, what would be your closing thoughts to this group? What would you share? What would be your final words to this group?
Well, I appreciate that. And I think it would be just to do what we talked about, and that is, in your own mind, decide that you want to succeed. And you know, if you're questioning whether it's real estate or not, well, come to a point where you make the decision it is real estate, or get out and do what it is that you want to do, but make that decision. And then once you've made
it, you can fully commit.
Then once you're in, you're all in. And just then do what it takes to succeed and never quit, you know, and it'll work. And you'll end up being able to, right now I'm at a different point in life. You know, I can kind of go to work if I want to, and I still
want. But you paid the price to do that, right? You worked when you didn't want to work. Up when you didn't want to get up. You exercised when you were didn't feel like it. You prospected when you were scared, fearful, didn't even know. You essentially had no training. Your training was live training in the actual, you know, in the field, if you would say. I mean, it's you paid the price to where now you reap the benefits and the beauty and the joy of all of those, of all the hard work, and you're reaping a harvest today because of it, which is fantastic. And it should be that way. Yeah. And sometimes people want the harvest before they put the, before they've gone and planted the seeds and, you know, hoed and tilled the soil.
Yeah, no, that's true. And you'll find as you go along, you learn to love the toil. And so even now, some days I think, what do I do for fun today? Well, I would love to help somebody buy a house, you know, so
yeah.
We'll try to, it's just, it becomes part of what's fun in life too.
It's awesome, man. I love it. Well, Ken, thank you for being with us. Thank you for being within the company. I know that when you got back from your church service and the things that you were doing, there's many people who would have loved to have you in their company, and we're grateful that you chose to be with us, and grateful for truly the example you are, specifically in the Utah market, and the things that you've done and how you live your life. And it drips with integrity from the standpoint of who you are and the example. And plus you created a beast of a son, Mr. Sam Bell, which we love and appreciate him in the company. And he's truly become one of the most important people to me in my life, and the counsel and the guidance that he helps and the things he does. So thank you for, you created a beast. So we appreciate that.
I think he started from the trunk of his car too. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely, Ken. All right, we're going to close up with just a few affirmations. And Ken, again, thank you for your time. And if people, obviously, I know that you would be so happy to visit with them. If there's anything, if you wanted to give a contact, or for people, of course, could call the front desk of the main office and get your number. But I know that you're so open to helping, serving, and blessing the lives of other people. So thank you for everything you do.
Okay. Be happy to help. Thanks, George.
All right, Ken. Thanks so much. All right. Here we go. Some closing affirmations. I succeed because I act on my goals. I am an optimist. I like talking to new people. Oh, my goodness gracious. I am so far off. I'm like, no, people. Yes, I am. I'm on. I know what is important to me. I remember people's names. I have a daily plan. I follow it. I am passionate about real estate. I know consistency is my greatest tool. I like asking questions and listening. I enjoy reading to improve my sales skills. My thoughts lead my emotions, actions, results. I focus on my dreams daily. My presentation is powerful and persuasive. I improve my skills daily. I am happy. I love the prospect because it feeds my business. I see my future and it is awesome. I love my life. I am grateful and thankful. I control my thinking. I believe in me. I feel outstanding. I use my beliefs and optimism to succeed daily. I get things done. I provide extra customer service. I drink water daily. I connect with people. People love me. I love others. I am disciplined and accountable to my daily schedule. I prospect daily. I set appointments daily. I'm a master persuader. I achieve my goals. I'm a real estate rock star. I am passionate about my life. I live every day with purpose. I am confident in my sales skills. I know my destiny. I am healthy and strong. I am powerful. I am unstoppable. I keep positive, exciting, fun, productive thoughts of mind all times. Yes. All right, gang, have an extraordinary day. Boy, I hope that you got some of those golden nuggets that I did and such sage counsel and such good advice for our future, for daily to, frankly, our lives. I hope you have a great day. Remember, nothing about this business you can't learn, and there's nothing about this business that you cannot do. So go for it. It is for the taking. Have a great day, and we'll talk soon. Life will never be. Life.